And so, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Straight Talk. Now, it is nice to be home. When Greg gave me the call and he said, would you host it this year? And he said, we've got three. He said, I think I can get these three gentlemen together. And he said, come in early April, the weather will be wonderful. So thank you for that, Greg. At least you got half of it right. Now, I was, of course, here last year, but my role has changed this year. It's like going from the hunted to the hunter. And we want this to be a very informal evening. Now, all of us would remember former Prime Minister Robert Muldoon's famous quip that when the New Zealander moves to Australia, he raises the average IQ of both countries. But of course, he was only half right in this case, as we've loaned out some of our greatest talent, and all three men, as Jane said, have graduated from this fine institution. Now, they graduated from this institution within 6 years of each other. So within a short period there. Now, 30 years later, it probably dates you a little bit, gentlemen, they are now running three of the four largest banks in Australia, responsible between them for assets over, I think the numbers are right, over 3 trillion New Zealand dollars. It's over 10 times New Zealand's GDP. A coincidence? I think not. So I want to welcome these three men, New Zealanders. Well, sort of two New Zealanders, one sort of honorary Kiwi, but we'll claim him just like we did Farlap. And we'll get back to that in a minute. Now, I know you've all read their bios. Impressive bios, three impressive CEOs leading huge organizations. So let me introduce them. Now, I'm going to tell you a few things that aren't in their bios. So Andrew beside me, Andrew Thorburn, Group CEO of National Australia Bank, born in Melbourne, but he spent the next 20 years making up for that when he was here. And in one Twitter feed, and I quote, he was called just as Kiwi as the pavlova. He's a man who believes in keeping fit, is quite an accomplished, drum guy? Bashes the drum kit in his garage, and he's clearly had a significant impact on National Australia Bank. Ian Narev, CEO beside him, CEO of Commonwealth Bank, famous to everyone of a certain generation as Davy from the 1979 TV series Children of Fire Mountain. He moved from acting to management consultancy to actually doing some real work in banking, clearly winning over his new bosses at Commonwealth Bank thanks to his combination, so it says, of intellect and empathy. You can be the judge of that tonight, ladies and gentlemen. And beside Ian, Shayne Elliott, CEO of ANZ. Now, according to bank insiders, Shane's father did not believe in borrowing money. So a career in banking was the obvious way to go. He was Citibank's youngest ever country head in Egypt, and I understand he's a vegetarian. I don't know whether those two things are related. Perhaps they are. So, gentlemen, welcome and thank you for giving up your time. Thank you to the team here, particularly Mel, for putting this all together. And this really is a unique occasion. I was talking to this gentleman before, and I think it was Ian said to me, this is the only place you could get these three together, and that's in New Zealand. And I think that's a credit both to the business school here and the university, but also said something about what New Zealand does to pull us all back. Now, this is Straight Talk, so we're going to cover all the big issues. And just to add to that, that pressure, we've got a couple of the parents sitting here as well. So that will add a bit to the pressure. And I'm going to open up later on to questions from the audience. And the only rules are you can ask whatever question you wish, which is why it is called Straight Talk. So let's get started, gentlemen. Now, they sort of don't know what I'm going to say here. Sometimes I don't either. But just to get into the mood, we're going to start with I'll call it a quick fire round, just to warm us up a little bit, and these gentlemen don't know what it is. So Andy, let's start with you. a man with a potential conflict of interest. Do you prefer rugby or Aussie rules? Always taking way too long.
This is quick fire.
Aussie rules. Okay, Ian, Penfolds Grange or Cloudy Bay?
Oh, see?
Yeah.
You're not doing well, boys.
Cloudy Bay, I'll go the paper.
Cloudy Bay, here. Okay. Bondi Beach or Mount Maunganui?
Oh, Mount Maunganui.
Gym or the pub?
Pub.
Truest. Suit or jeans?
Jeans.
iPad or pen and paper?
iPad.
Here's a tougher one for you. Bill English or Malcolm Turnbull? Okay, got it.
Bill.
Bill? And the one, the question that anyone can answer, the first one on the buzzer, and this was honestly a question that was asked to Donald Trump's nominee to the Supreme Court during the Senate confirmation hearings. And I kid you not, would you rather fight 100 duck-sized horses or one horse-sized duck? We believe that we...
That says it all.
Yeah, it says it. You've got to go the horse-sized duck.
Yeah,
you've got to go the horse-sized duck.
Yeah. So the ducks have it. Okay. So again, Andrew, we're going to do things tonight in a few things. We're going to start with these gentlemen's thoughts on leadership. And as I said, all three of you are alumni of this fine establishment. I think we actually have some photos somewhere.
Yeah, I've got to look at this.
Magnificent, isn't it?
I think you take it, Ian.
Yeah, what about the mo?
Magnificent specimens, aren't they? Gentlemen, I know I bet it only seems like yesterday, but I'd like you to cast your mind back to those distant days. It's over 30 years ago. So, Shayne, let's start with you. Any standout memories of this place that, particularly Auckland Union here in Auckland, that impacted your leadership today? And I guess with Kiwis overrepresented leading big business, particularly financial businesses, not just in Australia but around the world, what is it about this country? Let's start with sort of a nice nationalist question here for this audience. What is it about this country that propels people to the...
Well, the first thing you notice coming back is that it shrunk, actually, and it feels a lot smaller than it was when I was here at university. But I think, actually, I was lucky. I was here at a time... Well, it's hard to say it was lucky. I was here at a time when Muldoon was Prime Minister, and studying economics and business at the time when we had a price and wages freeze, that was interesting, you know, thinking through those kind of issues. But actually, the reality was... went out into the workforce right at this amazing time when there was this huge liberalisation of the New Zealand economy, and you know, to be a very, very small part and a witness and to see all of that was really just an amazing opportunity. And I think the great thing about New Zealand was the size and scale of where you were working was small enough that you could see it all, and we're going through this huge transformation, and you know, you just learn a lot when you're on the ground going through change, and that to me was what really set me up for, you know, my future.
What about you, Ian? I mean, you spent a long time in this place. What set you up?
I don't know whether shadows are still around at the university, but some of the great existential conversations of the world took place there, as far as I'm concerned. Actually, one memory I've got of the university, which came back to me today, and Vaughan and I were talking about it a bit earlier, I took this course, and I think it was 18100 or 18101 English Literature, and it was jointly taught by Roger Horrocks, Don Smith, and Sebastian Black. And they were sensational, passionate teachers. Really, and I've had the benefit of studying in a couple of universities overseas, and the quality of some of the teaching of the caliber of those individuals, they really broadened the mind. And to sort of combine that with the question of what's unique about New Zealand, a lot of people talk about the can-do attitude, etc., which I think every country talks about to some degree. But what I do think New Zealand's got quite uniquely is there's a complete absence of pretension in this country. And I think for leaders in organisations today, that's a pretty good trait to have. because the days of leaders being able to see themselves as sort of great people that others respect just because they're leaders, etc., are, if they're not long gone, they are not long for this world. And to that extent, I think the sort of the New Zealand psyche and the New Zealand culture is actually quite conducive to good leadership.
And Andrew, do you think there's a lack of pretension in Australia? All you three gentlemen were CEOs in big jobs really young. Now, I read some research last week that suggested that a lot of really good CEOs had big jobs in their 30s. Do you agree with that?
So I think on the first part of your question, I think I wouldn't describe Australians as pretentious, but I think there's been a degree it's had 25 years without the recession. And I think that's bred a degree of entitlement and a degree of complacency, which is dangerous today. There's no doubt about that in my mind. And I think to the point of CEOs in the 30s, I would agree that I think you need stretch, you need to be stretched, and you need to get breadth, I think, to be a CEO. So one of the reasons I think in New Zealand, particularly in the banking sector, we have actually standalone banks. And if you can come through those banks, you get to see at close quarters how a whole bank works, which is when you're in a big bank in Australia, it's much harder to see that. You see your bit, whereas in New Zealand, you get to see the whole and learn from people who lead the whole. Ralph Norris is here tonight. I think one of my most significant mentors and influencers on that very point. And you get to see it all. And I think you get stretch assignments and you get breadth as a result of that. But I don't know whether you need to be a CEO in your 30s, but I think those other two points actually do help you see what's possible and fuel your ambition and fuel your skills to be able to do it if you ever get the privilege to run an organisation.
Mm. And you did management consultancy before you went into the banking world, and you got your first jobs. And if you look back now, what do you wish you knew then that you know now before you were a CEO of a huge organisation?
Oh, lots and lots of things. I mean, the interesting thing, and this is not unique to leaders, but it's certainly relevant to the leadership context, the quality of the decisions you would make every day early in the job, if you knew what you knew later, just changes exponentially. And I guess the moment that isn't true, that you get kicked out. But interestingly, I think the challenge for many people, and I started in law and then went to consulting and then to the bank, and like Andrew, one thing we have in common is Ralph. And I was lucky to work very closely with Ralph when I made the transition, but the transition from thinking interesting, good, big ideas to actually seeing them through is night and day. And if you manage to do both successfully, that's a great combination, but one does not guarantee success for the other, and in many cases, they don't go well together. So as what I guess I wish I'd known back then was, if I knew what I knew now how to get stuff done, I think some of the strategic thinking I'd done earlier would be a lot stronger.
And what about the role of consultants? Do they know how to get stuff done?
Well, interestingly, one of the reasons that I ended up in the Commonwealth Bank is because I was consulting to the Commonwealth Bank, and a very esteemed banker who will remain nameless, who's in the third row, said to me, well, if you love working for the Commonwealth Bank, the only choice you've got is coming here, because I'm not paying a dollar to you as a consultant. That was sort of the environment at the time. Look, I had a terrific 10 years at McKinsey. I think it's one of the world's most extraordinary firms. I do think, though, that knowing when to benefit from the really strong problem solving, the global reach, and those really unique skill sets, which is a small subset of the time for big stuff, versus not using them as an excuse to let your people stop doing their job. That's the magic of knowing how to use consultants.
Well, and it looks like Ralph Norris, of course, gets the Mentor of the Year.
I don't know about you, Shayne. What's he done for you?
Yeah. Nothing. Actually,
another we can introduce you.
There's still time.
And another one of the same team, of course, was Ross McCurran, who's now the CEO of Royal Bank of Scotland, who's a friend of mine in the UK. Now, Shayne, I want to bring you back in, because these two gentlemen spoke about mentors and the importance of that. Did you have the same sort of experience with mentors and coaches?
Yeah, I had a very different path. So I was by total accident, I ended up working in an American bank, Citibank, at a time when its culture was all about You know, just hiring good people, giving them a chance, a real meritocracy, and that was my experience. I worked there for 20 years, and 18 of those 20 years was a great experience, and they lived up to their promise. And if you did a good job, they would give you more. And they just had a great attitude towards people. Along the way, I worked for some great people, and, you know, the people that I worked for, people like Mike Hawker, who, you know, and others, and I, the advice I give a lot of people in ANZ, and I did when I was city, is like, ensure that you choose great bosses. Ensure that you good work advice. For great people. It's one of the most important things you can do in your career. And you know great bosses because they're the ones that will nurture you and look after you and push you and test you and stretch you and actually let you go at the right time as well and move on. So I think it's a critical part of all the people that I see and that I admire and I see around organisations that have done well. All of them can point to those one or two bosses in their career that really pushed them off into the right direction and took a chance on them.
And Citibank obviously had an amazing legacy. And it's a small world. Mike Hawker's actually on my board in the UK.
Yes.
So, but what went wrong in Citi then?
Oh, how long have you got?
It was a great training ground, right?
And then
It was a great training ground. It was
one of the, you know, great. I think one of the great organisations, not, you know, a global organisation. You know, when you worked there, you inherently knew this was a global company and a meritocracy and all those good things. What went wrong is, you know, we did a merger and we thought we were infallible and we tried to merge together a different, you know, an investment banking culture and a commercial banking culture and, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of thought given about how that was all going to work out. So it was in the kind of times pre-financial crisis when, you know, there was a lot of deregulation and it was really about the cultural clash though, I think, and the lack of clarity about what we were about. What our culture was, what we believed in as a company, it wasn't clear anymore. And that's part of the reason I left. It wasn't that same place that believed in people and its world of view.
Mm. You know, the UK seems to have invented all the sports that everyone else excels in, you know, soccer for the Brazilians, cricket for the Australians, rugby for us. Now, the other sport that they've got to a fine art in the UK is the art of bank bashing. And the Australians seem to have perfected that sport. And recently, I know the three of you were in front of a parliamentary committee being grilled, and there was calls for a Royal Commission. And there seems to be, is this part of a wider trend of declining trust in institutions and business leaders? And what do you think about it? And what are you doing about it?
Andrew, what are you doing about it?
I think there's no doubt because of the 24-hour news cycle that things can get overblown and run that don't deserve really on merit to be so. But around the world, people have been impacted by banks that have collapsed through bad management and bad decisions in what are essentially, you know, leveraged institutions. So I think banking as a profession and a craft needs to absolutely be respected. And you see when banks get it wrong, particularly in North America and the UK, you know, the impact on society, on taxpayers, to actually address that and how long it takes. We talked about Ross McEwan. Ross is doing a great job there. But, you know, he's still got years to go probably to address that, and that happened in 08. So that's my first point. The second point is that underneath it, I think, there is a view, particularly I think in Australia and the US, and Brexit drove the same issue, that people feel left out, don't understand, it's all moving too fast. Some seem to be doing well and I can't yet afford to buy my own house and how will I ever be able to do that? I think there's that. And banks become, big business, government, become targets for that disappointment and anger. So I think that's part of where it's fueled from, including the banks have made, you know, a mess in some senses. However, let's come to Australia, because the facts don't support that the Australian banking system overall isn't doing a great job, because if you look at the way it went through the GFC, the lending that continued to households and businesses to keep the economy growing, that's been part of the reason why Australia's had extended growth. It has continued to be profitable and has not called on, you know, government bailout. It was assisted in some part, which the banks paid for during the post the GFC. It's continued to be profitable, and 80% of the bank's profits get paid back to shareholders. Most of them are Australians, directly or in super funds. And before the bank makes a profit, we probably, between us, employ nearly 100, over 100,000 people, clearly. People get paid fortnightly and, you know, it works. And generally, the service levels, sorry guys, I'll give you a shot in a minute, but the service levels, the service levels have been excellent. If you look at, you know, the digitisation of Australian banking and what's possible and the transfer of money and the ability to get loans and with brokers in the market, the service levels have continued to go up. And they're profitable, cost to income ratios are excellent. So overall, I think the Australian banking sector is in very good strength. Now, I think all of us would agree there are some bits that we're not proud of that are largely in the past and have been acknowledged, owned up to, and are being addressed. And so that, you know, we could go on about that, and maybe Ian and Shayne will, but my view, Mark, is there's some of the reasons, but actually, overall, the Australian banking system, the facts support it's well-run, well-governed, and actually it's standing very well in very difficult times, and that's really important for what the future is likely to hold.
So I agree with all of that, 100%. I think though it's fair to say our industry, like a lot of other big businesses, lost touch with the community in terms of the way that we spoke about our businesses. We took a lot of those things for granted, that and people would understand that, that people would understand the role of banks, that people would understand that, you know, who the shareholders and we pay the dividend and all that stuff and what we do for society and how we allow people to start businesses, own homes, save for their superannuation, whatever. But actually, we shouldn't have taken that for granted, and people forgot. And we didn't do a very good job. And we got caught up in talking about returns on equity and profits and all these ratios. They just go over people's head. And we can do a better job of just talking more simply about what we do. Because that's what we do. We actually allow people to buy that first home. We allow people to save for their retirement. We allow people to start and run and grow businesses that employ other people. You know, we're kind of the oil in the machine. And I think we can all do a better job of just talking more plainly to the community at large and reminding people what our role is.
Yeah, and we were talking before, and you said you didn't see the same sort of bank bashing or big business bashing in New Zealand, and it was a different sort of psyche. Why is that?
Well, I think the banks here are great banks. I'd like to say it's just the ASB. and it is. No, seriously. And I say that about the Australian. So I really think the New Zealand banking system is extremely well served. And I also think at the moment, and this sort of goes to the point Andrew was talking about before, I'm not in the school, and I know Shayne and Andrew aren't either. None of us are in the sort of the blame the political environment. It's just we're sick of people doing that, and it just sort of completely avoids the point. What I will say is that, and it may not feel like it in New Zealand at times, but we see this from the outside, the nature of policy debate in this country is so constructive relative to just about anywhere else in the Western world. And therefore, and this sort of comes to Shayne's point, the role that business and the banks play in the policy environment is just well understood and well led. And, you know, to sort of tie that together, I think there are two points of view that I've got on this which build a bit on what Andrew and Shayne have said. Number one, which is the bit that's in our camp, and this is something I've really learned in my time in the job, which is we've got record levels of customer satisfaction across the banking industry in Australia, yep. And we are proud of it and we should be proud of it. But the thing that I've learned is that if we've got 10 million customers, as we roughly have at the Commonwealth Bank, and 0.1% of those are having a bad experience, that's 10,000 people.
Yep.
And they're having a bad experience with their money. So if I said we've got 99.9% satisfied customers out of 10 million, most people would go, that's great. We do need to pay a bit more attention now to the whatever the number is, because I think all of us would say we probably haven't done enough on that.
Yep.
But part B is we've also got to be prepared to just stand up and say at certain times the debate is fact-free and it's cynical and it's poor. And if we're not willing, at the same time as we say there's stuff we have done and we have to fix and we're going to, but we've also got to be prepared to call out other institutions in our economy that are letting down their constituents, and there are a few.
And I would add, I think one of the sectors that we're all facing into to say that we need to do more work with is small business.
Yep.
Because, you know, how the housing market is well developed and, you know, there's a lot of competition, and the corporate institutional market a bit the same. But this small business piece, which is the fuel of growth in most economies, you know, they don't have time, there's difficult contracts, there's legal issues, there's complicated words, doing its point, not to change point, not plain English. So I think that's the sector we're sort of saying, we need to do more work here to lift our game and build, rebuild some trust and our reputation with that sector.
Can I move on to a slightly related topic then about the role of banking institutions going forward? We're seeing with the global digitization happening, you're seeing, for example, if you have a look in Asia and China, the biggest payment systems now aren't banks. I mean, Tencent, the largest tech firm in China, over Chinese New Year did 46 billion individual payments on their own platform. So how do you, as sort of large players in the banking system like you are, how do you cope with that sort of technological change, and is your role going to change going forward in society? You've got Alibaba as well, I guess, which is which they see themselves now as a competitor of yours. How do you cope with that?
Well, I mean, I don't know that there's anything terribly new in that. I mean, our organisations have been around for a couple of hundred years, and right through that period, things have changed. And the business models have changed, and new people come along and threaten and take away parts of our business, and that's just normal evolution of business. Actually, the reality is it keeps us on our toes, and it pushes us to be better and smarter and think harder about what we've got to do. I mean, you know, sometimes you come to work and you'd rather those things would just go away, obviously, but that is the system. That is that kind of creative destruction that happens, and, you know, our business models will change. I personally think the idea of, you know, complete ownership of the entire kind of value chain within banks is not the way forward, and I think it's going to be more about partnerships, et cetera. You know, a lot of those these competitors who come in with new payment system run off our rails that we've built, and that's fine, and we have to figure out ways to accommodate that and shift and change over time.
Yeah, I agree. I think the mindset of people inside our banks today needs to be a mindset of focused on the market and focused on clients and competing well, and thinking much more broadly and globally about who our competitors are, because obviously there's ones we know well and ones we can't see that are in the shadows and are getting significant venture capital funding and have a completely different mindset. And I was reminded of this last year when I was in San Francisco, and I was walking back to my hotel after a day with investors. I was crawling along the road. And I went past all the big banks. You know, it was like 7 or 8 o'clock at night, all the big banks, lights off, and I got to a building that I'd been in earlier today that had quite a few VC firms, lights still on, right? Hungry, want to beat us, right? And so our mindset, first of all, has to be completely different. Our people, that we have to think much more expansively and think of our new competitors in a really different way. The second thing is that I think we do have to think like we're technology and innovation companies ourselves. And I know we're all doing work with, you know, labs and R&D and ventures. We're all trying to learn as quickly as we can. And I think actually the banks have got a good chance, given our technology capability and the way we've adapted over many years. I think I still believe, you know, we've got a very good chance of winning this in the long run. I think one of the things we have to deal with, though, is, you know, there's a lot of regulation, more regulation. Now, good regulation is important for any industry, particularly banking. But I think if you layer more and more, banks become inward-looking, boards become inward-looking, CEOs spend too much time looking back rather than looking forward, and we become too risk-averse. Now, that is not going to beat these players. So I do see that as something that we have to navigate through culturally and with policymakers.
I mean, it's interesting. I mean, we get a hard time with that. We're not innovative enough as an industry. But I think, again, the facts don't support that. I mean, I recall I joined ANZ in 2009, came to Australia, and, you know, then 2000, it's not that long ago, there was no mobile phone banking in Australia or New Zealand. It didn't exist. 2010 it started, and now it's one of our top channels, if not the top channel for interacting with our customers. That's happened in a really short period of time. That was built and paid for and innovated by banks, and now it's just become an accepted norm, and we have to keep challenging ourselves. And I think over time, the banks have actually done a pretty good job. Well, does that mean we have to work differently with fintech, you know, and partner and adopt some of those ideas? Absolutely. But it's not as if we've been, and I'm not Pollyanna on this. I understand we've got to do better, but it's not like we've been sitting doing nothing. And I think actually the story of innovation in banking and these markets is really interesting. You know, simple thing like PayWave, tap and pay, cards. You know, Australia and New Zealand lead the world in adoption of that technology. Okay, that's developed with Visa and MasterCard. But, you know, we've done those things, and we've provided all those things essentially for free to customers, you know, and that's one of our challenges, because people want to actually have all of the new stuff and keep all the old stuff as well, and that's, of course, one of the challenges in terms of cost and compliance and all of those things as well.
You know, the only thing I'd add, because I agree entirely, and I think the imperative for innovation is very, very immediate. To pick up on Andrew's point, there are two mistakes we can make. Number one is completely underestimate the level of transformation. Yep. But equally, we've got a pretty good hand of cards. And the thing I think gets lost in a lot of the debate is the social utility of banks is about maturity transformation, i.e. Shayne wants to deposit a dollar and have it on call, and Andrew wants to borrow it for 30 years. We make that happen. We also know how to assess and price risk. And that's actually, these are the reasons why we exist. And a lot of that, we're a bit in, I mean, I remember, everyone will remember in 2000, we were all told retail banks aren't banks anymore, they're retailers. Well, guess what everyone found out in 2008? Banks are banks. Now we're hearing banks aren't banks, they're technology companies. Well, guess what? We're still banks. But we have to be exceptional at technology. But the reality is, and I had this argument with somebody in the US who told me that they can do better credit scoring from a Facebook profile than our risk managers could do. And I remember saying to him, let's see how people's Facebook friends change the next time there's a financial crisis. And let's see whether your analytics are still good, because our risk people remember what happened to property developers in 1990 in Australia. So we've also got to realise we've got very strong cards in the game. And if we build the technology around those and keep those strengths, we should be able to do pretty well.
Yep. And you've got a customer base. Now, talking about global change, I want to move us on just a little bit to another big area of global change, geopolitical change and the global trends around that. And I'll start with you on this. So one of the biggest changes, of course, okay, we have Brexit, but let's put that to the side for the moment. What about Trump? Storm in a teacup, or do you want to run back to the hills in New Zealand and hide?
No, well, here's a bit of the frustration I had. And I spent a few years living in the US, and I follow US politics very keenly. And you know, what my own politics are on this are irrelevant. He probably wouldn't have been my personal first choice for president, but that's not the point. The bit that was missing, this sort of goes to Shayne's point earlier, there were all these people lamenting about Trump, all this hand-wringing about how could he. The reality is 50 million Americans voted for him. Mm. And you can say what you want about electoral colleges, etc. This is a democratic outcome. And rather than complain about the candidate and have all this hand-wringing and bubble op-eds where people are telling each other who read their papers how bad the world is, what actually people who are worried about it need to do is get in touch exactly to this point about what is the underlying sentiment people are reacting to. Because the fact that should bothering people, if they don't like Trump's politics, is a legitimate worry, he's president. But regardless of a view on that, the question is, he is a legitimate outcome of the democratic will of a big country. And actually, that's the debate people ought to be having, rather than this whole, how could he do this, which I think sort of misses the point.
And what's the impact, Jim, what's the impact on Australia and New Zealand? You've got US-China tension, partly from Trump. You've got what I call a moratorium on multilateralism, so you're not going to have the same block trade deals, TPP, et cetera. You're going to have bilateral trade. What's the impact on China's role in the world, and what's the resulting impact on New Zealand and Australia? It's quite a big question.
Well, I don't know that anybody knows. I just didn't say, so we live in a volatile, uncertain world. That's not going away. If anything, it's possibly increasing. Maybe that's to do with media cycles and technology and allowing us to be, you know, there was a great article in The Australian not that long ago pointing out that, you know, 30 years ago, mums and dads would have seen the Australian Prime Minister, would be the same in New Zealand, once or twice a quarter in the newspaper. Now you are hearing from them every day, multiple times. They're tweeting, they're talking through social media. So, you know, so we live in a more volatile, uncertain world. Our job is to help our customers navigate through that, whatever that might be. And, you know, we have to sit there and help them understand what that risk is to their business, and help them mitigate that, whether that's around currency or funding or debt or whether they should expand their business or not. But I don't think it's my job to sit and have an opinion or a view about what that will mean and therefore, you know, drive customers down a certain path. It's really to prepare them for that uncertainty.
Yeah. I would say I do think the risk has gone up in the world in the last 12 months or so. It does have a... I agree with Shayne, you know, that's the way I think as leaders now we have to be, have our organisations on a war footing, perhaps the wrong term, and be much more adaptable and able to handle whatever happens. I think that's the case. But it does affect Australia and New Zealand in one respect, and that is that we are importers of capital. New Zealand has diminished a bit, but we still are importers of capital. One of the things I said at the House of Representatives when I went up a few weeks ago, before you guys in this case, it's like, we don't know how the batting order works, but it was like, there it was. It was a green wicket. And
there was plenty of shine on the ball.
They had a new ball for both ends too. But I said, look, since I was here last, NAB alone has imported $10 billion of funds from overseas markets, and we are now using that to support the growth in the Australian economy. Now, they didn't want to talk about that, but that is actually, we are importers of capital. So if the world is uncertain, rates go up, markets are more difficult, then that is going to have an impact on our economy and on our welfare. There's no doubt about that in my mind. The best thing, though, that can happen is that we get growth in the US and growth in China. That's the best thing for our countries. And at the moment, that looks actually pretty good. But the Trump factor, who knows where it's going to go. I think certainly the checks and balances in the US political system are working, but how he plays this when his five big initiatives, he's about to go up on the third one and get it knocked back, how he handles that as a character, I think, I think we just have to have our organisations ready and strong and resilient to be able to move in different directions at different speeds, because we just don't know. The uncertainty in the world has gone up, in my opinion.
He'd be glad on straight talk, wouldn't he? Maybe that's an idea for you for next year. Andrew spoke about rates. Now, we've been in a decade of low rates, pretty much, and consumers aren't used to... I guess the rates are higher in this part of the world, but consumers in most parts of the world aren't used to rates. You've got negative rates in other places in the world as well. What happens when they go up? And one thing is for certain, at some stage the will, it's only a matter of timing. What happens?
I think there are a couple of angles to that. And yes, it is a low rate environment, but it's not the first time the world's experienced rates going up. And we were talking before about the rates people were paying when they got their first mortgage. The first thing I'll say is that by the nature of our institutions, we are lending money based on rates going up, and rates going up pretty significantly. So every Australia and New Zealander who is being assessed for serviceability of a mortgage is being assessed as if rates were, 2.5% higher at least.
Yep.
So that doesn't mean there can be no problem, but what people can assume is that banks don't lend as if rates aren't going to go up. I think the bigger question, which is much more the macroeconomic question, is if you go back 3 or 4 years, all the debate was around what happens at the point at which this massive unprecedented expansion of central bank balance sheets and stimulus stops, and we were all talking about inflation and that whole debate, and all of a sudden it went away. And it went away because people started, whenever there's a mantra, my instinct is always the opposite's about to happen. So my instinct that rates would go up started when everyone started saying lower for longer, because there was a new mantra and a new tag, and everyone told everybody lower for longer, and in the meantime we forgot that debate about what's going to happen when monetary policy gets reversed. We still don't know the answer to that question. And while I don't see that as being a catastrophe, I think we've all got to be very careful about the fact that everything from the tapering in the US to the enormous stimulus put in by the European Central Bank, no economist based on past history can tell you how that unwinds. And therefore there's a range of outcomes we just need to be very careful of. That, in many ways, that worries me more than what is the impact of 1% or 2% on interest rates, which can make families struggle, and we're all attuned to that, but we think is manageable.
Hmm. Well, what about a domestic issue here then? There's still plenty of people saying around the world that New Zealand house prices are still unsustainable. Do you concur with that? And what would you do about it? I mean, versus GDP, versus average incomes, the house prices are still, would appear from the outside, to be high. Shayne, what do you think?
Well,
I was saying to a team this morning, I've been hearing that house prices in Auckland are unsustainable for a long time. And
20
and
years.
Yes, exactly. And at some level, you know, the market is what the market is, and there are buyers willing to pay those prices, and so kind of from a purist point of view, that is the price. I think from a risk perspective, there's more risk of prices going, you know, down than there has been in the past because of that and because of the inherent levels of leverage in households. And so when you kind of look forward, you think, well, household income isn't going to be growing that fast. Households can't continue to lever up a whole lot more. So you probably, you know, the issue that you've got in both countries, though, is there's no silver bullet to this. And it's not a, you know, in Australia we talk about we're changing negative gearing or stamp duty or whatever. Yeah. I think it needs a quite a comprehensive policy approach around that, dealing with both supply and demand. And what we run the risk of at the moment is trying to look for magic one-off solutions. And if anything, they're actually making the problem more complicated and more difficult to deal with. And so it's finely tuned. I think the banks, we're actually very, very lucky in Australia to New Zealand to have really good regulatory framework. And the new kind of macroprudential rules that are put in place, frankly, have been a good thing. And they've actually taken a little bit of heat out of the market, and they've served us well, and they've served the economy well. But the way forward is a bit more complex.
You concur?
Yeah, I do. I, if you look at Auckland, Sydney and Melbourne the same, but Auckland prices have gone up 100% in 10 years. Yeah. And that's because, you know, it's an attractive city, both people coming from within New Zealand to seek jobs, be with families, go to university, and immigration into New Zealand in the last 10, 20, 30 years has been extraordinary. And that's actually a really positive thing. I think that's actually one of the positives for Australia, that there is population growth. I think that is fundamentally good, but when you don't have long-range planning for your big cities, it's a big issue. I absolutely agree with Shayne. Everyone wants simple solution. Let's reduce capital gains, negative gearing, deposit. And I think they do have a impact at the margin, but they don't address the problem because it's a very complex problem. And, you know, in Australia, we know the 30-year forecasts for Sydney and Melbourne are essentially for those cities to double. Now, we live there now, and it's hard enough to, you know, navigate around cities like that. There's got to be long-range planning, 10-year planning, between banks, business, government, state and federal, to, you know, there's cities like Geelong and Ballarat and Bendigo and Victoria and Newcastle and places like that in New South Wales, where we should be thinking of those as destination points, building the infrastructure, schools, internet, hospitals first, so they become places. So I do think there's a long-run planning issue, which goes to one of the things that everyone wants now is quick, easy solutions, mantras. Let's get it fixed and let's do it next month. And some of these things just require more discipline and patience and teamwork to solve longer run issues.
I think there's another point to this, because I think the discussion on house prices is very important, particularly from a housing affordability perspective. From a banking perspective, I would twist the debate a bit and say what concerns me more, when I say concerns, interests me more, is a good discussion about household debt and making sure people take on levels of debt that they're comfortable with for their household. So my dad, in the second row, is a war refugee. He hated borrowing money, a bit like your dad. And I remember the day he came home and said, I've paid the last cent of the mortgage off. And this was a big, big moment. Now, that may be right for some families, may not be right for other families, but I think the debate about making sure people can have good, affordable houses where they want to live, where they can send their kids to school, etc., is absolutely critical. That's part A. Part B is just making sure that we're all having the right conversation about what is the right level of debt for individual families or businesses to have that suits their lifestyle, their risk appetite, etc. Because actually, I'm a bit less worried in many ways, other than affordability, about the house is worth X or Y, and much more worried that a family has a level of debt that they have sort of stumbled into. They can still service, so from the bank's perspective, it all looks fine. But actually, in the meantime, they've stopped taking the kids out to play, and they've cut back on the things they wanted, and that's not a healthy way to be.
Can I just say, because both Shayne and Ian have talked about their dads, I just have to mention my dad. I don't think he had any problem with banks, but I must say, the story goes on. He's a Scotsman, so he did have a particular view about money. And I remember when I first got my first job, he brought in this little bit of paper and on it was a big number, and he said, that's how much I'd cost him so far. That's a true story.
Well, my daughter's sitting in the front row. I might do the same this after this. So,
well, they'll be higher than me, for sure.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, one of the interesting issues for us as an industry is actually the changing nature of the workforce and that assessment about affordability. Well, I'm talking about your ability to pay debt. You know, at a very simplistic level, our model, historical banking model, was really simple. You walked in with a pay slip, and we assumed that you're going to have a pay slip that sort of looks like that for the rest of your life. That was the assumption we made, and we lent you money on that basis. Actually, increasingly, that is not the case. A, people walk in with three pay slips because they've got three jobs. They work not, you know, they work in a different kind of economy, more casual work, part-time. And actually, the chances that they're going to have a pay slip that looks exactly like that from the same employer in 5 years is diminished very, very fast. So how we react to that as an industry, we can't ignore it. We can't just say, oh, we're only interested in people who've got full-time employment, you know, and secure jobs, because that is not the nature of work. And that's going to, I think that's going to be a really big shift that we need to think through from a risk point of view. You know, the fastest, I don't know the stats in New Zealand and Australia, the fastest growing part of employment population are people with multiple jobs. And this is not the working poor that need, this is out of choice. People who drive for Uber, have a little business on the side, and then work, you know, on the weekends in some industry. It's a choice, people. That is the fastest growing part. Small numbers, but very fast growing. And how we think about that is going to be really a challenge for us, because that's not our business model.
Can I move, gentlemen, to a hard topic? Politics. Now, the Australians seem to change their PM about as much as the Auckland Blues change their coach. So you must almost be due for another change soon. Can you just give us a bit of an overview? What's happening in Australian politics? How it's impacting you? And of course, we have an election coming up here soon. Just any comments on that? I don't mean who you want to win and stuff like that. I mean, what are you looking for from politicians on both sides?
Well, look, the thing we were talking about before, and oddly, as we've been increasingly battered by politicians, I've certainly developed a greater sense of empathy for some of the tough aspects of their job. And I don't say that as an apologist, but I say, we were talking before and we said, imagine if our teams, so our direct reports and their direct reports is roughly 100 people. Imagine every time we sat down with them, they were going to vote on whether we would still be the CEO. I would hate to think where it would come out.
It would be a different straight talk tonight,
exactly.
Right?
Okay. And the reality is that if you look at Australian politics, and I think the defining period is really the sort of middle to end of the Rudd period to today. Mm. And I joke with David Murray, who was Ralph's predecessor. He ran the Commonwealth Bank for 14 years and served under two prime ministers, and I've done five and a half, and I've served under four or five. But the dynamic that was created then was because of the very fluctuating nature of opinion polls and the febrile nature of politics, there was a lot more ongoing discussion within the party room about who should lead, even where that person was the Prime Minister. That is a very, very difficult environment in which to lead. Now, there can be arguments about who's to blame for that, etc., but the reality is that while we have that environment, you will not have stable policy making. Because part of what oppositions can do is play not only against you in the court of public opinion, but try to destabilise your own party room. And, you know, there are far better human beings than me around, but I would find it extremely difficult to formulate good policy in that sort of environment. And until we're out of that environment, until we're in a position where a leader is in a position of stability for a period of time under which good policy can be made, it's going to be tough. New Zealand has had the opposite experience.
I think,
go ahead.
No, I was going to say, there's also been an environmental change, you know, and it's different in Australia than here. Australia went through this massive change. We had this enormous mining investment boom, where mining investment was 8% of GDP, and now it's fallen back towards 2%. And that has been a massive change in the economy. And along the way, actually, the place did pretty well. And it managed to grow through that and replace jobs and all of that stuff. But along the way, there are 1.7 million Australians who are either unemployed or underemployed. So people want to work more and they can't. So there's a natural question about the system and saying, is this actually delivering? The globalisation question, is this system delivering for all? So when you agree with Ian's point and then you overlay this huge change of people questioning the system, is it delivering for me and my children? Very much the same stuff you hear in the US. the first time generation in Australia saying my children are going to have a lower standard of living than me. Right? That's not the same in New Zealand. That is a real question. And so people are looking for alternatives, and you can understand that. And they're looking for somebody to blame as well. And you know that we cop a little bit of that.
I would just add, I do think in Australia, over time, it's become a less cohesive, aligned, unified country, believing in the same sort of values and the vision of what it stood for. I actually think New Zealand, when I first came here in 1983 to go to university, I think over that time, it's become more like that,
yes,
in my view, whereas it wasn't like that at the beginning. Australia's gone in the other way. I do agree with Ian. I think it probably, in political terms, developed in the late time period of the Howard era, when we had a lot of immigration issues at the time that were very angsty. And then since 07 and beyond, I think politics has become so personal, terribly unpleasant, to put it in a minor way. And what we need politicians to do, because underneath it, I think Shayne's point is that it's people have become fragmented and disconnected. That's what's happening underneath. There's a little fire burning there.
Yep.
So a lot of the MPs are hearing that when they go back to rural parts of Queensland. You say, yep, they're hearing that. They're lining up and they're saying, I'm unhappy and look what's happened. And so they take that back to Canberra and it's just got fragmented. But in the end, it's got to come down to leadership.
Yep.
And I think there's a lot of politicians who are very good people, very well-meaning, certainly when they start out. But you need leaders. I remember recently talking to Mike Baird, who was the New South Wales Premier, who'd been in politics for 10 years. He just said, it's exhausting. It is so personal and it's exhausting, right? And he was a banker, going to become a banker again. But, you know,
and a big success.
Yeah, and very successful. But, you know, if I could point to him, but I would just make the general point, you need character, you know, conviction-based politicians to say, this is going to be my plan. It's a good policy plan, and I will stand accountable for that. So elect me or don't, but this is what I want to do, make and create change that's good for our country, not be in power. And I think we need more political leadership, but we need businesses, banks, everyone to realise the future. But if you're in politics, you're there to make a difference and to serve people, and I think the best thing you can do is put out some really strong statements about what you stand for and over the course of 3 to 5 years, what you'll commit to changing.
And stick to it.
And stick to it,
yeah. Well, ladies and gentlemen, a few minutes I'm going to open up for questions and we have a whole lot of mics. Before I do that, we thought we'd give these gentlemen here, they don't get together that often, we know that, at least in this sort of forum, and we thought we'd give these gentlemen the chance to ask each other a question. Being the fine competitors that they are. So who wants to go first?
Right, I'll go first. Shayne, your daughter's 13.
11 and a half.
11 and a half.
Yes.
Wait till she gets to 13. what career advice are you going to give her and why?
That's a good question. We haven't got to that stage yet. That's a really good question, Andrew. I haven't really thought about it. I mean, I think in all seriousness, we're very privileged and live in an incredibly privileged life, and the reality is that our children will be able to essentially do whatever they like, and as much as I'd like, I didn't have that opportunity, yeah, and I don't know if that's a good or bad thing for my daughter, actually, and that's one of the things that I struggle with as a parent. It's like that great, and we're not in that position, it's that great Warren Buffett line that says, I want to leave my children enough money that they can do anything they like, but not enough that they can do nothing.
Yeah.
And I think that's the challenge with my wife and I's child, trying to think that through.
Yeah.
How do we make her passionate about something and really want to do something? Because reality is she will have many more choices than I did.
You've
got young children as well.
Yeah, I have, and the thought of any of them having careers at the moment is just more than I can conceive of. I think, and it's a little bit aligned with what Shayne said, I mean, I think the one thing, and again, this comes from My family background, where having watched my parents and my cousin who's here, the number one thing about getting a job was provide for the family before you think about anything. So I would want my kids to understand that there's a reality of you've just got to get by in the world, and it's your job to make sure you and the people around you can. And then B, though, just try and give them a bit of the freedom to go with what they really love and want to do, whatever that is. In our family, you had a choice of being a lawyer or being a lawyer. And not that's not what I wanted to do, Dad. I really, really did want to do it. No, but seriously, so if there's one thing that you can, you know, yes, you've got a big responsibility as part of your job to provide for yourselves and others, but just try and not limit yourself too much by what you want to do.
And what's your question?
I'm interested in knowing from these guys, so at that moment on a Friday afternoon at about 3 o'clock, where the week's gone really well, and you're in your office and you get that call, and we've all had it, and somebody's ringing you with that bit of bad news, which is totally going to ruin your week, even though it's already 3 o'clock on a Friday, what's your mechanism for dealing with that? What have you got a standard?
And what?
And I know that 99.9% of our jobs is all upside and fantastic. So this is maybe the one day a decade where this happens.
I was going to start
by saying,
if
somebody could have a camera of you in that room, what would it look like?
This concept, you know, you said the week has gone so well to that point. I was thinking that's a concept.
Exactly. I look forward to that.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to that week. When does it happen?
If you said, like, when you're sitting in your office at 3 o'clock on Friday, in between 2 and 3, things have gone well, and then you get the call. Now, I think this is a really good point, because I think, firstly, sometimes I'm sure I don't handle it well, and my response is not what it should be as the most senior leader in the company, you know, and to put it crudely, I'll probably shoot the messenger, you know, and that's not good. And I usually know that's happening and can... And often I've rung people back and said, look, I'm sorry, all right? However, most of the time it's not like that. I think my job here is to listen to the substance of the issue and understand what's happened and, most importantly, what's being done about it, and to try to acknowledge the person phoning you to tell you that. So I think it is, but I, you know, because I think the biggest impact is actually your behaviour on other people. It's not your intent, it's not what you mean, it's not, you know, it's like how you land, right? So I think most of the time I handle it well, but I do hang up and say, oh gosh, right? But I try to be, you know, to hear it.
I need to take notes.
In all seriousness, I don't generally get upset with other people, I get upset with myself. And so honest answer, I tend to listen to those and take it fairly calmly. Because I'm really conscious of that, you know, you don't want to, you need people, you want to encourage people to ring you at 3 o'clock on a Friday afternoon and tell you bad news.
Actually, I might ring you. What are you doing? No, on Friday.
But you do, and, you know, I tend to get more upset at myself on issues rather than other people. So, those things, they actually don't ruin my weekend, though. You may find that hard to believe. One of my very few strengths, I'm very good at generally switching off over weekend. I hate working on the weekends. I've never done it. I don't like it. I will travel on weekends if I really have to. I don't read work things. I really try to switch off. To me, that's really important for my mind to have a rest and to just be focused on, you know, I take my daughter to swimming and piano and birthday parties and all that kind of stuff like everybody else. And that, to me, is an important recharge.
And while you have the mic, the question.
Oh, look, I'd just be interested to know if either of you ever, at what point did you ever realise you had the desire to be the chief executive of a large organisation?
It's going to come sometime.
Yeah, the next one.
It's quite actually profound question, because when I joined the bank, and Ralph will know this, in 2007, I didn't dream, you may have, you probably did knowing you, but I didn't dream in a million years I'd ever outrun the bank. And actually it was quite close to the succession process happening that I was asked the question, are you going to put your hat in the ring? And you've got to be really serious about it. And I went home to my wife, Frances, and I said, couldn't believe what I'd been asked. So the reality is really late. Like, I would say that the thought first crossed my mind within a year that I might ever be a CEO of a big company about a year before it happened, candidly. Interestingly, on the point, though, and this sort of goes to the 3 o'clock point as well, I think a lot of people assume they want to be. And I think for a lot of people, success is your boss's job. And the counsel I always give our executives at the bank is, it's great if you want your boss's job, but you don't know it very well. And make really sure you really do want it versus just assuming you want it because it's the next rung up the ladder. Because, it's got its pros and cons.
Yeah, it does. You're absolutely right. When I became the CEO of BNZ here in 2008, up until that point, I just loved banking the challenges and what was before me. That's really what I had been thinking about. When I became the CEO of BNZ and I saw the real challenge and delight and breadth of customers and different businesses and being, you know, like your companies in New Zealand, you know, national icons and the real, you know, difference you could make, I really started to love it. So when I was at BNZ for 5.5 years, I really loved the job.
Right.
And so for me now, going to NAB was a completely different step up and different challenge, but I sort of knew the nature of it and I loved it. Having said that, I've always tried to, you know, hold it lightly, and if it wasn't this, you know, I always thought, well, there's going to be something else that I really am passionate about, that I want to make a difference to people, and if it's not this, it'll be something else. Mm. So it wasn't something that I was focused on and said, I want to get. You know, it just was a natural evolution.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, sadly, we're out of time. You can see why these gentlemen are in the roles they have. Thank you for your openness. Thank you for the fun as well. It was a great evening. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the New Zealand Aussie Financial Mafia.
Good. Thank you. Well done.
Thank you. Well done.
Thank you. Well done.
Thank you. Well done. Thank you. Well done. Thank you. Well done.